At the weekend, two Irish women live-tweeted their journey to the UK, where one of them had an abortion. It generated much debate online and brought back into sharp focus the most politically sensitive social issue that this government has vowed to deal with. Should it last long enough? With the Citizens' Assembly just around the corner, putting in motion a process that will most likely end in a referendum on the Eighth Amendment. Tonight, we take a look at the arguments that have dominated both sides of the debate. Joining us to discuss this are Louise O'Reilly, Sinn Féin TD and spokesperson on health, Cora Sherlock of the Pro-Life Campaign, Janet O'Sullivan of the Abortion Rights Campaign, and Sinead Slattery of the Pro-Life Campaign. If you would like to comment on the programme, you can text us at 53131 and place the word tonight before your comment. Or send us a tweet at #FinB or email us at tonight@tv3.ie. Cora Sherlock, whether we like it or not, the likelihood is that the next 6 months to a year are going to be wall-to-wall abortion in terms of our public debate. And I'm just wondering what it's like to be a spokesperson, to be front and centre of the pro-life campaign, and even in relation to social media and that, you know, how does it affect your mental health to be checking social media after an appearance such as this?
Well, I think I don't check social media after an appearance like this, to be honest, because it gets quite late in the night and I think you're finished with the issue at that stage for the night. But I think what is really important over the next few months is that regardless of what our position is in Ireland, it's not just me as a spokesperson or anybody on this panel who is a spokesperson for a particular side of the issue. What I would like to see is that we have a proper and fair debate in this country. And by a fair debate, I mean one that isn't dominated by publicity stunts or by sound bites or by just one side of the debate. What I would really like to see is a discussion and a conversation that we can have that acknowledges the importance of every human being in this country and that looks at both sides, as I say.
I'm curious that you, from what I've seen even in relation to social media, that there can be an awful lot of abuse sent the way of somebody like you, somebody in your position?
There can absolutely, and there is a huge amount of abuse. And I suppose, you know, the reason I'm involved in the debate, in the abortion debate in Ireland, is because I believe abortion is bad for women. I'm not in it for the good of my own interests. You know, I take on that abuse, and it is very serious at times. But I think it's very important that we have a serious debate.
So would you call on both sides, both those in your camp and what you'd consider the opposing camp over the next couple of months, to try and stay away from that sort of insulting language?
I always have, you know, and I've never used insulting language myself. I think that everybody deserves the respect that really what is at the centre of the abortion debate is human dignity, the human dignity of every human being born and unborn. And I think that that should continue through the discussion, through the way the discussion is carried out. And I hope that to be the case.
Janet, do you believe we're capable of a civilised debate on this issue?
Well, as a person who's spoken about having travelled for an abortion myself, an awful lot of the rhetoric online can be very hurtful. We can get an awful lot of abuse. So I would ask anybody engaging on this topic to be civil. That's the very basic thing, polite manners. You wouldn't say it in front of your mother. Don't say it to a strange person on the internet. It is really that simple. But we do need to change some of the language and we do need to destigmatise it. It's one of the reasons the abortion rights campaign is called the abortion rights campaign. But for too long, we didn't even use the word abortion in this country. We had the substantive issue. You know, and even now we have people talking about the repeal the 8th. And yes, repeal the 8th does affect medical consent for everybody in this country that can become pregnant. It does affect birth rights. It does affect our entire maternity services. But from our point of view, we're the campaign to broaden the existing abortion rights in this country. So it's really important that we use the word.
Louise O'Reilly, you're a newly elected TD. I think we can still consider you that. What's been your experience of dealing with this issue and the response that you get from people? You're somebody who is in favour of repealing the Eighth Amendment. And what sort of communication do you get from people on that?
Well, I could break it down into two camps, Alison. you have some very respectful interactions. We debated in the Dáil what generated the hashtag mixed bill, but it was a bill on allowing terminations in the case of fatal fetal abnormalities. Now, I was there that night. It was a fairly emotionally charged debate. There was general consensus, by the way, that we need to have a referendum, and I don't think there was anyone really that spoke against it. But it was a very respectful environment, a very respectful debate. But it was kind of like that because we were nearly all agreeing with each other, in that we were all agreed. There was differences around the timing, but I think we were all agreed that the issue does need to be advanced. But I have been...
Where were the dissenting voices that night, do you think?
I don't know, actually. I don't know. But I don't know that there are that many dissenting voices. I think that people have come to the realisation that we need to have a referendum. I think that the referendum is going to happen. I think there's an air of inevitability about that, finally. And I think that people are resigned to that, and now they're waiting. They want to have the debate. And I do. I would echo what Cora has said and what Jan has said. I think people should try to be kind. I think they should try to be respectful. But I also think...
How likely do you think that is, though, given our history?
This is the point I was trying to make, is that initially some of the correspondence that I get is horrendous. You talk about the stuff that you wouldn't say in front of your mother.
What do you mean by horrendous?
I mean... personally insulting emails. I mean, online abuse levelled at me personally, which
now,
I
don't expect you to give detail, but when you say personal, do you mean things to do with your performance, your appearance, or simply your attitudes in abortion?
So is it something like, well, you know, there's that... whatever.
Okay, abusive term.
Yeah, description of me, and she's talking about this issue again, and there she is now. No wonder she's saying, you know, repeal the eighth. She hates this, she hates that. And stuff that's not true, quite apart from anything else. And it is very hurtful, you know, because my family members...
Are we surprised by it?
Do you know, I wasn't. I'm tired of it already, you know. It's a case of, and you know it's coming from a very, very small number of people, but you can balance that against the amount of positive. Now, following that debate, I got a huge amount of positive feedback from women. Some of them very, very short emails. Some of them just, you know, thanks for your contribution last night. Others from women saying, you know, that
Do you
they...
think the increased number of female TDs that were elected in the general election made a difference to that debate, even in particular, the tone of it, the direction it went in?
I'm not sure, because I think that we were fairly evenly matched, men and women speaking that night.
Okay.
I know that there were more women than men in the chamber, but the men were in and out, as politicians very often are. And, you know, the debate was... I think it was respectful in its tone, and I would hope that that will set the tone. I think we're all able to just ignore the stuff, exactly what Jan has said, you know, the stuff you wouldn't say in front of your mother. Ignore that.
Some of the most powerful messages I've gotten over social media over the last 4 years have just been two words, and they've been, me too. From women, because we know over 160,000 women have made that journey to the UK. So for them to finally hear themselves being spoken about in a respectful way, to finally see their journey mirrored in what the two women did at the weekend. Because I've looked at those flowers, the same flowers that were tweeted. So we have a lot of women out there and the people who love them.
Sinead, what's your take on what happened at the weekend, the journey of those two women and how they tweeted it, and even how they very specifically directed it at the Taoiseach and Kenny?
Well, I think, Alison, that while it told part of the abortion story, it didn't tell all of the abortion story. And that's how I felt when I was reading it. And I think there was three key points that weren't told as part of that story. The first point was that we didn't get an understanding as to why that lady was travelling to the UK for an abortion. We know she was travelling for abortion, but just not why. And the reason why I think that's important is because many women who have had abortions in the past come to us and say that oftentimes they feel like they've no other options. And I would like if the government, instead of focusing on repealing the eighth, actually offered women genuine support and sincere support services so that they weren't in that situation in the first place. The second piece of information, which I think was omitted, and unfortunately it is the uncomfortable truth, is what happens to the unborn in an abortion. And I think what happens for some women is they're not told about this beforehand and they find out about it after. I absolutely do not want to go into any detail, you know, and upset people, but there is an uncomfortable truth in terms of the physicality of what happens in an abortion. Was the child dismembered? Was there an injection through their heart? You know, that's a key piece of information that wasn't shared in that story, and it's something that we have to face up to, and it's the reason why millions and millions of people around the world are pro-life. And the third piece of information that I feel wasn't shared was we don't know how an abortion has affected this lady or specifically this lady. And I absolutely hope that she you know, goes forth and doesn't have any repercussions to it. But very sadly, what we've seen time and time again is that an abortion is not a risk-free procedure in the same way as a medical procedure is not risk-free for most people.
Janet, what is your response to that?
Well, we do know why this lady had an abortion. There is one very clear reason, same reason anybody has an abortion. They did not want to remain pregnant any longer. They did not want that pregnancy to come to term. They did not want to have a baby. That is the fundamental reason why anybody has an abortion. It's the only reason that anybody ever needs to give.
And what about what Sinead spoke about there in terms of what happens, the physicality of what happens during abortion?
92% of all abortions happen before the first 10 weeks. So, and this is the case of the majority of the women that travel to the UK.
Now, can I just ask, Janet, does that make ending of a life at 10 weeks less important than at, say, 20 weeks? Like, what's the difference between an abortion at 20 weeks than it is at 10 weeks?
They're two different procedures, and obviously the pregnancy is more advanced, and obviously at 20 weeks it takes a person's body longer to recover from having an abortion, which is why we advocate for free, safe and legal abortion. What stops later term abortions is early, timely access when somebody no longer wants to be pregnant.
I think, you know, what's very interesting in Janet's response is that it's fine if you ignore the fact that there is a human being's life being ended here. And that's what we, as Sinead says, we omitted to talk about that at the weekend. And, you know, there were two other very important stories that happened at the weekend, Alison. And we had the story of the Mary Stopes Clinic, which was obliged to suspend services in England because of serious safety and serious health and safety concerns that were raised. There was also the story about funding coming into this country from a billionaire in America, given to groups like Amnesty International, the Irish group of Amnesty International, the IFPA, and the Abortion Rights Campaign.
Janet, your group. How much money did you get from the Soros Foundation? What does the group intend doing with it?
It's a small amount of money. We haven't actually drawn it all down. The figure is online on our website, if anybody wants to see it.
How much is the
abortionrights.ie is the website. There's a statement there with the details, and it's a very small amount of money.
But can you tell, if it's on your website, surely you can tell us now.
It was a lot less than what Amnesty and the IFPA got. As far as I know, it was in around probably 20,000.
Okay, which and what is, will you be doing? Are there stipulations around what you should do
It's for education and ending stigma. We would love to be able to send out leaflets, like what the Pro-Life campaign did this week. I know several people got literature through the door, very high glossy A4 page.
Paid for by Irish people.
An envelope on it.
We need to draw a distinction here.
Irish people, when are you going to publish your accounts? Ours will be out in November.
I'll answer it, Janet, if you give me a chance. We need to draw a distinction between what was revealed in those findings. This is a billionaire's foundation. He has billions and billions of dollars.
The pro-life movement receive money from abroad?
Not from a foundation like that.
No, but money from abroad. What's the difference between a foundation like that and
Well, there's a huge difference, because it's not just the money that came in, Alison. What was attached to this money and what was clearly set out was that this person is strategising the campaign in Ireland. It was a very
Does that mean that people who give money to your organisation never think strategy are concerned about how you spend it?
No. You see, what the difference here is that we're talking about a foundation, as I say, with billions of dollars to be poured into Ireland to direct a campaign, to strategize a campaign. People who give donations, and I can tell you there are tiny donations. I had a look to see how much came into the pro-life campaign from around the world. I think last year there were 3,000 euros, and the year before that, 3,000. Amnesty got, I think it was 130,000 at the IFPA.
It's interesting, that seems totally at odds with what we think we know about the pro-life campaign, that it's massively funded from the US particularly. Are you saying that doesn't happen at all?
Absolutely, because the brochures that Janet is talking about and the leaflets that she's talking about, they're funded by people who support...
So how much money do you get from, you said Irish people, how much money do you get from Irish people?
Those are in our statements. These are people who are watching the programme and they want to keep their own country.
Just to tell us, from your statements, how much did you get last year, for instance,
We would have got a few hundred thousand from people around the country.
Like 500,000?
Not that much. Who are sending in...
And this is despite you knowing that you're facing into a very acute time where you'll need...
This is not about the pro-life campaign. This is about external donations coming in.
We started talking about two women who made a journey that 12 women make every day. You managed very skillfully now, and fair play to you, to move it on to a discussion about how Amnesty International is funded. Can we go back to talking about? We were talking about two women. My heart broke reading those tweets, because I'm telling you, there isn't a woman in this country, I don't believe, that doesn't know someone or is related to someone or has sat beside
Can I ask you then, I think it was that Cora said a few minutes ago, and she spoke about it brought out sadness in her, because as far as she was concerned, those tweets signalled the end of a human life. Did that cross your mind?
It made me very sad that these women had to leave.
No, but
Ireland.
did that particular thing cross your mind?
It didn't, because what I read in their tweets and what I read in their communications were women who were sad that they had to leave Ireland. We cannot sit here and say that Irish women do not access abortions. They do. We know they do. The only difference is they have to go abroad. And I think that is heartbreaking. I think that it's heartbreaking that the country turns their back on those women and that they tweeted Enda Kenny, and fair play to them for doing it, because he is the one who should take action on this.
All right, we have to take a break now, but we'll continue the discussion shortly. Join us then.
Imagine if you could travel back in time and drink a beer as it was brewed in the 1880s. Brewed with the world's first pure brewing yeast, discovered by Carlsberg and shared with the rest of the brewing world.
Have you got a letter from a grateful Dutch brewer?
Imagine if that beer was rebrewed with yeast from one of the last remaining bottles of that beer to have survived. Don't just imagine it, just imagine it.
You don't stop working hard, and we won't stop trying to find a better way for you to bank. So we've made a breakthrough. Introducing the new Explore account from Permanent TSB, the only current account in Ireland that gives you cash back in three new ways. With 10 cents back as you pay, up to 5% cash back on bills, and personalised offers on some of your favourite brands. The Explore account. Now you have three more reasons to switch to Permanent TSB. Keep going.
Stay happy with up to 8.5% savings off every electricity and gas bill year after year. Go online now.
You know, child, I'm kind of hard to beat. Just commence your feet to skate. Make it shake. Maybe if you think you're shy, do me a favor, honey, go someplace and hide.
Today is your day. Make the most of it with Centrum. Live every day.
We're discussing the Eighth Amendment and the issue of abortion in Ireland. Janet, the abortion rights campaign is gathering signatures for a repeal of the Eighth Amendment of the Constitution, to have a referendum on that. Why do that when the government has proposed a citizens' assembly that's about to get up and running in October?
We launched our petition online on Little Women's Day 3 years ago. So our petition's been running quite a long time. And we followed the guidelines as laid down on Oireachtas.ie. That is, our petition is official, in line with Oireachtas guidelines, and we will be submitting it very soon.
What numbers are you at now?
It's very hard to tell because we have the online petition, but we also have paper petitions and our 20 groups around the country. So we have to wait till we get it in from all of our regional groups and get them notarised.
But are we talking about tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands?
We had tens of thousands of people out last year for the March for Choice. We're looking at possibly having double that number on the 24th of September.
Okay. So, yeah. Yeah, it really doesn't give us a sense, though, having gathered signatures for the last couple of years of when will you be gathering them and getting a tally?
We're hoping to submit them in the next 6 months.
Next 6 months, okay.
Yeah. It's a large body of work, and we're a volunteer group with no paid staff. So right. It's quite a bit of an undertaking to get it done.
Yeah. Cora, the Citizens' Assembly, what's your opinion on 100 random citizens being chosen randomly to come in and to make decisions on this very thorny issue?
Well, the pro-life campaign has already said that we believe the Citizens' Assembly to be a pretend process with a pre-arranged outcome. And I think we haven't seen anything.
But how can you say that if it is going to be... I mean, I've seen people on both sides have concerns about the Assembly and the people who are going to be chosen. And surely that's a good thing. If both sides are unhappy.
Well, I think, you know, there's a couple of things here. Firstly, what we're talking about in the Citizens' Assembly is not anything that's going to have a comprehensive and open discussion on abortion. It's not going to look at all of the issues. We don't have any sign that that is the case, because, as I've already said, nobody could say that we're having a fair debate at the moment, that we're looking at all of the signs or all of the issues that arise. I've already mentioned the Mary Stopes issue. We should be really talking about that, because abortion is a women's health issue. And what I mean by that is abortion is something which is very bad for women's health. And we're seeing the results of that in Mary Stopes, which has had to close down some of its services.
It's an incredibly safe procedure. Well, it's 14 times safer than giving birth. When abortion is carried out in safe and legal conditions,
There is no such thing.
I'm glad to see
the
Mary Stopes services suspended. I think we need to be very aware as we move forward, and when we do remove the Eighth Amendment and we go forward to legislate and for policy for healthcare for Irish women here at home, we need to look at what the framework will be and the checks and balances. Any health service that does not live up to the standards set down needs to be looked at. I'm sure plenty of the women who went to the Lourdes Hospital and had symphysiotomies there and had forced hysterectomies there under Dr. Neary would have wished there was the oversight there is at Mary Stopes, someone to come in and suspend those services.
We don't need to go back to Dr. Neary's time. A couple of years ago, there was an investigation into a tax-funded state agency in this country, which was advising women going in a very difficult situations that they could lie to their doctors and say that they had a miscarriage.
No,
can I just finish,
the IPA,
Janet?
Uncredited.
It wasn't on credit.
Absolutely. There was no wrongdoing found. It was investigated.
You can take that up with the Irish Independent, because fair play to them for reporting on it, and to Gemma O'Doherty, who did sterling investigative work, which nobody else would do. But, you know, this was
if they broke the guidelines, the HSC would remove their funding.
Can I finish, Janet? Well, you know, most people don't know about that. What I would like to see is the fact that this was a state-funded agency which advised women that they could lie about the procedure and tell doctors in the future that they had a miscarriage and not an abortion. It coached women on how to import illegal abortion drugs. Now, we have a public representative on the panel this evening. I would like to ask, Louise, will you join me in calling for a full and open investigation into that scandal at the IFPA, which has never been discussed?
Abortion stigma is huge.
Something that was in the Independent, you're saying, hasn't been discussed. It was in the Independent newspaper. It hasn't been discussed and it hasn't been publicised.
But it was
in the Independent.
Two articles.
Well,
the IFPA have never
I think
appeared.
My understanding of that is that
appeared.
The IFPA have answered all of those questions
when
that were raised very clearly. But what I would like to say, though, is in relation to regulation. See, this is why we can't have a debate, because
every time I open my mouth, you try and shout me down.
I'm not shouting down. I'm asking you now
to let me finish.
Will you join me in calling?
What happened?
Will you give Louise an opportunity to answer, Cora?
Thanks, Alison. What happened with the Mary Stopes Clinic, I think, is a good news story. In the same way as when HICWA move into a nursing home or another health provider and close it down, it shows that we have oversight. What we don't have is the capacity to regulate for these procedures in our own country. But our women still travel in large numbers every single year,
so
and
Sinead,
that is wrong.
Does a ban on abortion, does it not just export the problem where Irish authorities can have no oversight on Irish citizens having medical procedures in another country?
I think there's an irony to that question because it's a procedure that is successful when a life ends. And if you look at the statistics, you know, in Ireland we have one...
But that is the procedure that the woman has sought.
Yes.
So therefore it's an Irish citizen who, I presume generally, of her own free will, for various circumstances, will travel and have a medical procedure in another country, and there is no oversight of that by Irish authorities.
Well, I think, Alison, like, the reality is that the reason why we are opposed to it is because in your line of questioning there, what you haven't mentioned is the unborn and their life.
No, but you mentioned you mentioned the unborn, and you did for the second time. So I think in a way it's to have that, of course, that is at the centre of it, but we've mentioned it on many occasions. Yeah. So it's understood that that is at the centre of what you're saying. So I'm just talking about the substantive matter of oversight and Irish citizens having to travel to another jurisdiction for this medical procedure.
Well, we just don't believe that abortion is the answer to a crisis pregnancy. And if you look at the HSC, who recently published bereavement guidelines for parents and for mothers who are carrying children with life-limiting conditions, and I quote, they say that abortion actually causes more emotional distress in the long term and in the short term than actually carrying through with the pregnancy. So we just don't believe that abortion is an adequate solution to a woman in a crisis pregnancy situation. And as I said earlier, there's just so many other things that we could be doing for it to help women.
Cora, can I ask
you? That leave every year disagree with you and disagree with you fundamentally. They are Irish citizens. They have a vote. They need to have a say. They haven't had a say, I don't believe,
it's
up until now.
Irish citizens. Miss Y was a migrant, and as a result,
exactly,
did not have the right to travel. Did not have the access to papers or visa. She had no support network in here in Ireland to support her. She had not access to funds to travel. So it's not just Irish citizens. It's anyone in this country who can become pregnant and do not wish to continue their pregnancy.
What rights do you think Miss Y had? Miss Y's baby had, Janet?
Well, Cora, it comes down to the basics of she was in a situation where at 8 weeks she found out she was pregnant. If she'd have been in any other country bar Malta, she'd have been prescribed the abortion pills, and 24 hours later the pregnancy would
but
have ended.
I didn't ask you that. I'm asking you, what rights did her baby have as an independent human being? Does that baby have a right to
human
be alive?
Human rights start at when we're born, Cora. Our human rights start when we're born.
Really?
Does that mean, yes.
Are you in favour of abortion right up to birth then?
I'm up to women being able to end a pregnancy when they need. We've already had both masters of our maternity hospital, but Rotunda and Hollow Street, say where a pregnancy is viable and a pregnancy needs to end, that they will do an early delivery.
But if we were to have pregnancy or abortion available here,
yes,
what would your, for a term limit, what do you think that should be set at?
We don't put term limits on life-saving and health-saving medical procedures. We don't, and we can't really put term limits on, because every woman is different, every pregnancy is different, so it really comes down to what is in the best interest of the pregnant person and their doctor. That's what safe abortion is about. It's medically supervised.
Can I just say at this point, you know, I think that we need to correct one very serious misconception. There's an awful lot of scaremongering going on in Ireland at the moment about this idea that Ireland is not safe if you're pregnant, and this idea that you can have a life-saving abortion. Abortion is not life-saving. Abortion is life-ending. And I think that, you know, it's not right to send the message out there that abortion is in some way good for women. We mentioned Mary Stopes already.
We did a number of times. I'd like to ask you, Cora, going back to the Citizens Assembly, I'm wondering whether the pro-life movement, how it would feel, or whether it would condone the idea that there'd possibly be protests outside the Citizens' Assembly, or that the people who are chosen to deliberate on this discussion would be the subject to any sort of abuse. Where would the pro-life movement stand on that?
The pro-life campaign has never engaged in anything like protests or any sort of aggressive actions like that. What we want to see, as I've said, is a fair and calm debate, and we will...
Janet, what would your take on that be in terms of...
Personally, I have very mixed feelings on it, because we've been told that the proceedings will be broadcast, they will be live-streamed. That gives openness, it gives transparency, we can see what's being said, mm-hmm. we can see the discussions and the points being made, hopefully we'll better inform the public. Unfortunately, it means that anybody who's taking part, their identity will be revealed by this. So I would have concern that they would face the type of harassment that Lorraine has spoken about. Louise has spoken about. And the type of harassment that other TDs have faced.
I know that you're not a fan of the Citizens' Assembly, but as an elected national politician, do you think that these citizens who will be chosen will be safe, will feel safe?
Oh, I'm sure they will. And I think that, you know, that is the job of the government, because it's their idea to make sure that that people feel safe. And not just safe to attend, but safe to speak, and safe to speak their mind, and safe to engage in the debate.
Notwithstanding that... You know, the argument that many people have put forward, that it's a delaying tactic. Do you think it can be of any value to have the discussion?
I think the discussion should take place on the floor of the Dáil, Alison. I think the Dáil is the Citizens' Assembly. We are elected by the citizens to meet, to debate, to discuss and to legislate. I do think, and I believe this, and I've said it on the record of the Dáil, that the Citizens' Assembly, as conceived by Enda Kenny and Simon Harris, is nothing more than a delaying tactic. I do think if we are going to have it, well then let us have it, let us have a debate, and let us move forward.
And Catherine's opponent, the Children's Minister, mm-hmm. has said, I think, that she is anticipating a referendum in, I think it was 2018. Would you see that as... You know, as obviously the big if being that the current government is still in power.
We have to wait until 2018. Mm. That's being honest with you. Now, I think that this is, and certainly from discussions that I have had, very, very wide ranging discussions that I have had, this is a settled matter. Not the result, but the referendum itself is a settled matter, I think, in the minds of many
Cora,
people.
Are you
I think if you seek to stop the referendum and to stymie the debate, you're closing your eyes and, you know, sticking your head in the sand and pretending that 12
afraid,
women every day don't travel when they do.
Is the movement afraid of a referendum, particularly given the results of opinion polls over recent years in terms of showing people being Irish people, a large number of Irish people being in favour of a liberalising of the abortion regime?
Certainly not. I mean, what this last weekend has shown very clearly is that it's the pro-life movement in Ireland that is grassroots based, it's grassroots funded. It's pro-choice campaigns and pro-choice organisations that have to go outside of Ireland to look for US billionaires to pour billions into Ireland to steer our democratic process and to interfere. I want to just pick up one thing that Louise said earlier on about there being general consensus that we have to have a referendum. Let's remember that when we talk about a referendum, there is no general consensus. We're talking about introducing a procedure and a regime which has led to, in England and Wales, 90% of babies diagnosed with Down syndrome being aborted. 1 in 5 pregnancies in England ending in abortion. That is far lower than Ireland.
I'm afraid we've run out of time, Cora. We'll be back for more discussion and a preview of tomorrow's newspapers after the break.
Imagine if you could travel back in time and drink a beer as it was brewed in the 1880s. Brewed with the world's first pure brewing yeast, discovered by Carlsberg and shared with the rest of the brewing world.
Have you got a letter from a grateful Dutch brewer?
Imagine if that beer was rebrewed with yeast from one of the last remaining bottles of that beer to have survived. Don't just imagine it, just imagine it.
There's a song we sing.
You don't stop working hard, and we won't stop trying to find a better way for you to bank. So we've made a breakthrough. Introducing the new Explore account from Permanent TSB, the only current account in Ireland that gives you cash back in 3 new ways. With 10 cents back as you pay, up to 5% cash back on bills, and personalised offers on some of your favourite brands. The Explorer can't. Now you have three more reasons to switch to permanent TSB. Keep going.
You know, child, I've got a heartbeat. Just commence your feet to skate. Pick up your arms and make it shake. Maybe if you think you're shy, do me a favor, honey, go someplace and hide.
Today is your day. Make the most of it with Century. Live every day.
Okay, a question for you. Have you been the surface of the moon recently? Or have you got what it takes to be the bridge of doom? What about being a nice safe nest for an endangered species? And when was the last time you battled a dragon? Or found yourself in shark-infested waters? Kinder Surprise, a treat for the imagination.
Find hundreds of ideas to help you enjoy cooking together in the new IKEA catalog. Search IKEA catalog or pick up a copy in store.
Now we'll take a preview of tomorrow morning's newspapers, but first I'm going to read some of your texts and tweets on the earlier discussion on abortion. Siobhan has tweeted, goes under the name at WellNowUniverse, the level of abuse and trolling by anti-choice anonymous accounts far exceeds any by pro-choice side. Disildoofus has tweeted, pro-choice is not pro-abortion, it's pro-choice. Allow women a choice, some will choose abortion, some will not, a very difficult choice. Joe Logue has tweeted, regardless of your stance on it, pretty refreshing and all too rare to see an all-female panel talking about abortion. Frank Browne has said, so impressive, has said, Cora Sherlock, so impressive for being willing to publicly advocate for the human rights of the unborn child, but respectfully. Now, we're going to move on to tomorrow morning's newspapers, the Irish Times there, and the lead story. Rio police say email evidence links Hickey and Evans. Moving on to the Irish Examiner, and it looks like it's wall-to-wall Olympics and Pat Hickey yet again. Police Hickey emails point to cartel. Irish Daily Mail, same again. Hickey discussed tickets with THG, that's the English group that sell corporate tickets, just weeks ago. Lovely photograph at the top there of Annalise Murphy with Granny Betty. I couldn't be more proud of Annalise. And the Times Ireland edition, Hickey, that's Pat Hickey. Hickey discussed illegal sales of tickets with Evans. And that's basically the story there, is that the Rio police have released these emails that show that Pat Hickey was in contact with the head of THG Sports on the eve of the Rio Games to discuss the illegal sale of Olympic Council of Ireland tickets. Louise, certainly Rio, the Brazilian police, seem to move at quite a different pace, don't they?
It's hard
to keep up.
But at the moment, the police in Rio seem to be the only ones interested in actually getting to the bottom of this. I do think that Minister Ross needs to put the inquiry on a statutory footing. He needs to give it some teeth. I mean, we're being outpaced by the Rio police at the moment over a matter that is essentially internal to Ireland. For a state-funded, well, not entirely state-funded, but for a body that does get a good deal of funding from the state, I think we do need to move the inquiry onto a statutory footing. And I know that we wrote to Minister Ross to indicate that today. I'm sure we're not the only ones that are saying that, but a statutory inquiry is the only thing. This is like an onion. Every time you move a layer, there's another layer underneath it. It's not reflecting well on us as a country. And I do think that we need to move it on. When you put that against the beautiful picture of Annalise with her granny, I was like, I think it's awful that would overshadow the achievements of our athletes.
And there's no doubt, you know, that the medalists have been overshadowed in their
achievements. And I think that's an awful shame. But part of that is down to the fact that Minister Ross didn't move quickly. He could have moved quickly, he should have moved quickly, and he should have headed this off the path, and he didn't.
Now, the other news that obviously we can't ignore, much happier news, is we have a winner of the Rose of Tralee, and she is looking at the Examiner there, a rose by any other name, and this year's Rose of Tralee 2016 is Chicago's Maggie McIldowney, who was crowned in the Dome earlier tonight. We will actually be discussing the Rose of Tralee tomorrow night. Is it just a lovely girls' competition or a feminist nightmare? So tune in for a take on that.
I saw her from the train.
Is this her?